This is Office Talk with Annette Stepanian.
Welcome back to another episode of Office Talk. You may have been hearing the term GDPR rumbling around for the past few months. Maybe you've seen a lot of emails coming through from your favorite companies about updates to their terms of service and privacy policies, and you're wondering, what the heck is all of this GDPR talk about? In this episode, my goal is to break down what GDPR is to give you some basic background and context to what the law is all about, what it means for your small business, why it's important. I've approached the topic not just as a lawyer, but as a small business owner myself. You know, I've had to go through GDPR and try to answer for myself, well, what the heck does this all mean for me as a business owner? What do I need to do in order to be compliant with GDPR? So, as always, my goals for these podcast episodes is to break down complicated topics into plain English so that you have sufficient education on a topic so that you can then have an informed conversation with a lawyer. Okay, I can't go through all the different nuances in a format like this without having the benefit of knowing more about you and your business. So, as with any legal matter, it's always best to contact a lawyer. And in this case, you want to talk to a lawyer who specializes in data privacy and protection laws, so you can get individualized counsel on how GDPR impacts your business. Also, before we dive into this, I want to encourage you to adopt a positive mindset about the GDPR. Okay, I'll be the first to admit that when I began educating myself on the topic, I was just overcome with a sense of dread. I just couldn't stop thinking about what a big pain in the butt this is. You know, after all, we're most of us are small business owners. Sometimes we're just one woman or one man shops. And now I'm being told that I have to worry about data protection laws in the European Union. Holy moly, like what the heck? The reality is though that this is happening, that it's probably gonna apply to your business. So let's put on our big girl pants and deal with it. Also, when you think about the reasoning behind why the GDPR was put into place, it was to really strengthen the rights and the privacy and security of an individual's data. Life has changed so much over the last 10, 15 years in terms of our personal privacy. We share our data with a lot of companies, our data is tracked by a lot of companies, and then we see a lot of companies vulnerable to hacks or data leaks, and that potentially exposes our personal data and gets it in the hands of people that we don't want that data to be in. When you look at it from that perspective, it's a law that is designed to not only protect the individual, but also to protect the businesses, because it's requiring that they beef up some of their security and the measures that they take to ensure that they're only collecting the data that they need, that they're only holding onto that data for as long as necessary and deleting it so it's not as vulnerable to some of those hacks and those data leaks. Taking it from that mindset and taking it from that perspective kind of helps justify some of the overwhelm that I think businesses are feeling when it comes to making sure that they are compliant with GDPR. So what the heck is the GDPR? Now, GDPR is a law coming out of the European Union that applies to the processing of personal data of data subjects. Now, the law has been in effect since 2016, and businesses were kind of given a window of about 2 years in order to get compliant with the law. So starting on May 25th of 2018, which is quickly approaching, that's the date when enforcement of that law is going to begin. So a lot of these, you know, big companies like the Googles of the world have been actually trying to get compliant with all of the GDPR regulations for years now. But May 25th is that date when they're going to say, okay, we're going to start coming around and making sure that you guys are in fact compliant with this law. Now, I want to start off by defining a few of what I call the key actors in this GDPR play. You're going to hear them used over and over again, and I think just having that defined up front is going to be really helpful for you. Now, a data subject is an identified or identifiable natural person whose personal data is being processed, okay? So think about, for example, a website visitor who comes to your website and they opt into your email newsletter, right? That user, okay, or that website visitor is going to be defined as a data subject in this GDPR world, okay? Because it's a natural person who is identified or identifiable natural person whose personal data is being processed. Now, I mentioned there were a few other actors in this play that we want to define upfront. So that is a data controller and as well as a data processor. A data controller is a person or an organization that determines the purposes and means a data subject's personal data is going to be processed. So for example, let's go back to that website example. You have that website with that email opt-in. Okay, you decide that you're going to collect a website visitor's data. So you're going to collect their name, you're maybe going to collect their email address or maybe their date of birth, right? So you can send them a coupon for their birthday. You, as that entity that is making these decisions, you are the data controller, okay? And now a data processor. So a data processor is a person or organization that processes personal data on behalf of a data controller. Going back to our prior example, when as the data controller on your website, you decide you want an email opt-in, and then you subscribe to some email service provider, and they are the ones who actually collect the email address, they store that information, they are the ones who send out the subsequent emails after the user subscribes, right? They're the ones who are processing that data. Well, they are the data processor in that example. You, as the data controller, go to the data processor and tell them how you want that data processed. Simple. Are we good? Are we all on the same page here? Okay. So what kind of personal data are we talking about? Okay, personal data is any information related to that identified or identifiable natural person. So this includes the basic things that you would think about, right? Like your name, an email address, a national identifier, a date of birth, an address, credit card information, right? It's those key data points that we can look to and say, okay, this belongs to Jane Doe. But it's a lot broader than that. The definition also includes identifiable information of a natural person. So even though maybe you may not have the name or email address of a person, you might have an IP address, right? You might have a cookie. You might have a tag that you use in your email software to tag that this user came and clicked on this website, so they get tagged with such and such a tag. It includes GPS data. So GDPR really captures a whole lot of data. So who needs to comply with the GDPR? Now, there's a little bit of a misunderstanding that only companies in the EU need to comply with the GDPR. Unfortunately, that is not the case. It is a very long arm reach. So even if you're a company that does not have a physical presence in the EU, you are still subject to the GDPR and all the rules and regulations that it requires if you provide goods or services into the EU and you're processing the personal data of EU data subjects. So if you're established in the EU, if you offer goods and services to the EU, or you monitor the behavior of EU residents, even if you don't have a presence in the EU, you're gonna need to comply. So I could hear you guys like groaning because I did it too. But I'm like, but what if I'm a one-woman shop, right? I provide most of my services here in the United States or my products here in the United States. I cannot control if someone from the EU wants to come onto my website. I'm not targeting people in the EU in terms of direct advertising. I'm not sending products there. It's just not my market. What do I do? Well, we got to go back to the definition. The GDPR says that if you're established in the EU, okay, you're not. You offer goods and services to the EU, okay, you're not. But you monitor the behavior of EU residents, then yes, okay. If you have traffic coming in from the EU, you still need to be GDPR compliant. And the GDPR applies to companies of all sizes, okay? This is really what's tough. So even if you're a one-woman shop and you're like, oh my goodness, I am not a Google, it still applies. You gotta remember, it's all about the personal data. So that is the trigger, and that is what the GDPR follows. The focus is on the data subject and not on the business. So before you blow it off and you think, whatever, I have other things to be thinking about, Annette, let's talk about why you should care and what happens if you don't comply. Now, the penalties are pretty steep. The penalties for non-compliance can be 20 million euros or about 4% of annual worldwide revenues, whichever is greater. So the folks who created the GDPR, They mean business. They really want, this is really going to be defining the way that all of us are going to be treating data and managing data and thinking about data security when it comes to our businesses. So I would, and we're going to talk about some things that you could start doing in order to be compliant with GDPR. Let's talk about data subject rights, because as I mentioned earlier, a lot of this is coming from the perspective of the data subject and protecting the privacy and ensuring the security of personal data. That's going to inform a lot of what it is we as business owners need to do in order to be compliant with the GDPR. So data subjects in the EU are now going to have a ton of rights relating to the processing and storage of their personal data. And I'm going to go through them. It's kind of like a bullet pointed list. So you kind of get a sense of what kind of rights these folks have now. The first one is the right to be informed. Businesses must be as clear as possible on how they're going to be processing data, who's going to process it, where it's going to end up. Data subjects must also be able to contact that data controller with any questions they might have about what that business is doing with their data. They have the right to access that data. So a data subject who wants to scrutinize the use of their data will have the right to access that data and confirm whether or not that data is being used lawfully. They have the right of rectification, which basically if the data is incorrect, you have to, as a business, correct that information. You gotta make sure that all that information that you are collecting is accurate. They have the right to erasure, which is, you might have, if you've been reading about this GDPR, it's being referred to as the right to be forgotten. With some exceptions, as there's always exceptions, a data subject can request that their data be erased. So there are, again, some exceptions as to when a business can hold on to that data. I'm not going to get into it because it just starts getting very hairy, but the idea is that a data subject has the right to request that you delete whatever data that you have on them. They have the right to restriction of processing. Okay, this right requires data controllers to stop data processing and ask permission for any subsequent use of that data. This means that if data is given to you for certain permissible use, and then you want to use it for a different type of use, you have to request and get consent and permission in order to use that for that new type of use. Right to data portability. So under the GDPR regulation, data subjects can request and reuse data held by third-party businesses. One example that was given in one of the courses I attended was, for example, let's say you have been using a grocery service, right? A home grocery delivery service. And they have for 2 years, you have all of your grocery purchases with that company. And now you want to go and start using a different home grocery delivery service. Well, with the right to data portability, a data subject has the right to request that you export that data and give them that data in a usable format that they can then now go and upload into that new home grocery delivery service. They have the right to actually get their hands on that data in a format that is basically readable and usable and then port it over to somewhere new. Data subjects are also going to have the right to object to the use of their data for direct marketing, for automated decision-making tools that basically make decisions based on past behavior like purchasing habits, locations, or basic demographics. So you're kind of starting to see that it puts a lot of power in the EU data subjects' hands. And not to forget to mention that these rights can be exercised at no charge to the EU data subject. And as a data controller, as a data processor, you have to respond to them within 1 month. Okay, so now I think we're all feeling a little overwhelmed and your mind is probably racing at all the different variations in which this could apply and all the different obstacles and challenges it's going to create for you as a business owner. In terms of thinking about the GDPR and the obligations it imposes on your business, here's a framework to get you to start thinking about how to comply with GDPR. First thing I would do is I would take a look at your people. I would take a look at your customers. I would take a look at your email subscribers. I would take a look at wherever you're housing personal data and look like, do I have people in the EU? Does this even really apply to me? You know, do I have a presence in the EU? Am I selling goods and services in the EU? Am I monitoring the activity of people in the EU? I'm going to say probably most of us are in some capacity, but you kind of want to get your hands around that. Like, what does this look like for me? Is it that like 90% of my population are EU data subjects? Now, if you come out of that analysis and you determine, wait, I don't even have anybody in the EU, there's nobody's ever bought from me from the EU, or nobody ever from the EU comes to my website, I still would not dismiss the GDPR, because the GDPR's standards are so high that complying with the GDPR is probably going to ensure that you have a pretty solid data privacy, data protection policies within your own business. And it's really going to beef that up for you. So I wouldn't dismiss it if you find yourself that this is probably not applying to you, okay? I still would pay attention. Okay, so the second step is determine if you are a data controller or a data processor. Now, I'm going to assume that most of my listeners here are playing the role of a data controller, where you are using other third-party services and providers to help you process your user data. So for example, maybe you sell digital products online and you use a third-party service in order to process those credit card purchases. So regardless of what role you're in, decide first what role you're playing. Then I want you to start inventorying all the systems or third-party service providers that house data subjects' personal data. You literally just make a laundry list. Take a look at all the softwares that you use. Look at all the, you know, apps that you use for your business, all the tools that you use for your business. And then within each of those, I want you to identify what data is being collected, how it's being processed, how it's being stored, and how it's being deleted. And so just take an afternoon and jot this all down. As to the last point about how it's being deleted, one of the principles of GDPR is data minimization. So this means that you should only collect what you need, the bare minimum, and you should only keep that data that you've collected for the period of time that you actually need it. So if you don't need it, you've got to delete it. With this step three, for example, you use software A to collect, let's say, two data elements. That information is then shared with person X, Y, and Z, and we keep it for X months. So you want to kind of get a handle like how this data is flowing through your business, and which is our next step. Step number four is I want you to understand the transfer of data between you and a third party and identify whether your data processors can demonstrate GDPR compliance. So let's say you are a small business owner, you sell online courses, and you use X platform in order to deliver those courses. So what I want you to do is go to that platform, to that company who hosts that course software, and find out, do they have an independent validation from an audit firm certifying that they are currently GDPR compliant? You can contact them. You can look in their terms of service, their privacy statements for this information. But the point is you want to only be working with people who are and can certify GDPR compliance. Once you have a good grip on how the data is flowing through your organization and with your data processors, you've confirmed that, you know, you're working with data processors who are GDPR compliant, let's review your terms of service and privacy notices. A core principle of GDPR is transparency. You've got to say what you do and you've got to do what you say. These documents need to reflect what your data collection, data use, data storage, policies and practices are, and they have to be concise, they have to be complete, and they have to be in plain language that anyone can understand. Okay, so this is where we don't want a whole lot of legalese. The user has to really understand, if I come to you, what information are you collecting from me? What are you doing with that information? How is it being stored? Who is it being shared with? You've got to be transparent here. And perhaps it's obvious, and if you haven't already been doing this, I hope you are. If everything you're doing is outlined in that notice, which it should be, you got to actually make sure that you're actually doing what you say you're going to be doing in that notice. If that's a document that is accurate, it's up to date, it actually is always reflecting what's going on in your business, which means that you're probably going to need to revise it from time to time. Step number six is we need to start documenting consent. Okay, so you need to document and provide evidence that a user has given you consent. And consent of a data subject means that the permission has been freely given, it's been specific, informed, and unambiguous, okay? Permission has been given by a clear affirmative action signifying agreement to the processing of their personal data. The data subject's consent has to be via clear affirmative action. So this means that silence, pre-ticked boxes, or inactivity does not constitute consent. They have to actually take an affirmative step to agree that you are going to be processing their data. The GDPR guidelines also advise that consent should cover all processing activities carried out for the same purpose or purposes. So when a processing has multiple purposes, consent needs to be given for all of them. So an example, just to kind of break that down for in terms that we can understand, let's say you are, again, you're in the business of selling courses, right? So a customer comes to you, buys your course, you send out emails to them to deliver that course and whatever, you know, whether it's a digital download or any of those follow-up emails about, you know, a receipt and whatnot, that is okay. They've given you consent there to email them for that purpose. And then let's say you then add them onto a general marketing list where you email them occasionally about different products and promotions and things of that nature. Well, you've got to get consent for that as well, right? So you've got to get consent not just for the purpose of delivering that purchase, but also if you want to continue communicating them with, for in terms of marketing purposes, you've got to get that consent. All that consent that you get has to cover all of the purposes in which you are going to be using that data. Moving on, step number 7 is to determine if you have controls in place to delete data. Remember when we talked earlier about this data subject's rights, they have the right to be forgotten. So with some exceptions, they can come to you and say, hey, I want you to delete all the data that you have on me. Well, do you A, know where that data is? Hopefully you do because you did what we talked about a few steps ago. You've mapped out your data and how data flows through your organization, what data is being collected. But hopefully you're working with data processors who have the ability that you can reach out to them and say, or have the ability to do it on your own to delete that user's data from your systems. Step number 8 is to determine if data can be ported. Again, a data subject's rights includes data portability, where they could come to you and ask, I want all the data that you have on me. And so you have to have the means in which to do that. And step number 9 is to review the security controls and determine if there are any gaps. So we didn't talk a whole lot about this, but one of the things under the GDPR is data security. And what it does is it imposes this requirement that if there is a data breach, it must be reported within 72 hours. And it doesn't matter if the breach is with the data controller or the data processor. Now, I know this is probably going to sound so overwhelming because so many of us are like, but I pay for all these softwares to process my data. Like you're talking, now I have to be involved with data security, you know, and reporting and all this stuff. And so I get that it's super overwhelming, first of all, but what I would do is here, just take a look at when you are reviewing your third-party service providers, all of your data processors, and making sure that they are GDPR compliant. You know, you want to think about what kind of security measures do they have in place? Do they have the ability to monitor and report out in a timely fashion for any breaches that might happen? The key here is to just recognize that the onus does not fall on the data processor here. You as a data controller here have a responsibility to report out within that 72-hour window. So something to just take note of and start thinking about if you haven't already about what is that plan going to be should that ever happen to you. And step number 10 is to regularly review your processes and your policies to ensure that they are compliant with GDPR. Things are constantly evolving as it comes to technology. We're all starting to use new tools coming up. Your business might be growing. So you want to keep a consistent pulse on what is going on with the data in your business and make sure that you are complying with the rules. Again, the law is also evolving. So GDPR, yeah, it's been in place for 2 years, but enforcement's going to start up here in a few weeks, and it'll be interesting to see what kind of enforcement actions they bring and how that's going to shape the law as well. The moral of the story here is, my friends, that GDPR is real. It's happening. It's probably going to be applicable to you and your business. So it is something that you need to be thinking about, just like taxes and employee-employer regulations and things of that nature. The GDPR data privacy rules and all that stuff is going to become one of those pillars of legal considerations you need to be making as you are growing your businesses. So I'm hoping that this has given you a good background and some good context in which to think about it. This is by no means a complete discussion of GDPR. It is a beast. It's a monster of, you know, to think about. But I'm hoping the 10-step framework that I've given you here has kind of allowed you to kind of wrap your hands around it a little bit. And I really encourage you to educate yourselves on it and to reach out and seek counsel from somebody who is a data privacy and data protection expert. Get their counsel and let them help you set up your business so that you are GDPR compliant. Okay, you guys, that was a big topic. I appreciate you being here and staying through the end. Again, it is not the sexiest of things in my life and in my business. There are things I just don't want to deal with as well, but it's part and parcel of being an adult. So this is one of those things. This is definitely one of those things that are an adulting type of thing. So I encourage you to adult, put on those big girl pants and make sure that all of these things are buttoned up for your business. Okay, you guys, thank you so much for being here, and I will talk to you next week with a fresh episode. It's going to be an interview. It is such a fun episode. I can't wait to share it with you guys. Before you skip to that next episode, I want to invite you to a special event called Legal 360 Live. In this live online summit, we're going to walk through what you need to know, legally speaking, as you start and grow your business. So if you're ready to roll up your polka-dotted sleeves and finally get your legal house in order once and for all, head on over to yourlegalbff.com/live. That's yourlegalbff.com/live.